This is Don Gossett. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord.
The Bible commands, remember the works of the Lord. Today, Don Gossett shares his experiences of working with several key leaders in evangelism. Don will apply the truths that can assist you in being used of the Lord. Now here's radio friend and teacher Don Gossett with Remember the Works of the Lord.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that's within me. It's a delight to my heart to share the works of old, the works that God performed through the lives of people with whom he joined me to be an associate. And when I left them and have gone out these years in my own ministry, it's often been a source of encouragement to remember how God worked in days past. I was in Bangkok, Thailand. My team and I had just concluded weeks of ministry in Yangon, Burma. And there on the other side of the world, God spoke to my heart in a vital way. Now, I've been studying the New Testament as it applies not only to my heroes, but to you and me. There is a phrase repeated throughout the book of Acts and the epistles, simply proclaiming the Lordship of Jesus. Each time this phrase dynamically magnifies the name of our Lord Jesus. I remember when I was preaching across Eastern Europe, in Romania, Moldova, the Ukraine, my godly and anointed interpreter was Pastor Johnny Buya. He would say to me, when I interpret your preaching, when you say Jesus, I seek to reverence his name by calling him the Lord Jesus. Well, that experience led me to study all the references I could discover with the significant phrase, the Lord Jesus. And as it applied to my heroes with whom I worked, this was a tribute to their character and passion. They loved and honored the Lord Jesus. So I want you to go with me today to some scriptures that this phrase has gripped my heart. Notice each of these phrases right from the Bible are about the name of the Lord Jesus. Acts 1:21, that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us. Acts 7:59, and they stoned Stephen, calling upon God and saying, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. Acts 8:16, for as yet he was fallen upon none of them, only they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Acts 9:29, and Paul spake boldly in the name of the Lord Jesus. Acts 11:20, preaching the Lord Jesus. Acts 19:5, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Acts 19:10, all they which dwelt in Asia heard the word of the Lord Jesus, both Jews and Greeks. Acts 19:17, and the name of the Lord Jesus was magnified. And then Acts 20:24, the ministry which I have received of the Lord Jesus. Acts 20:35, remember the words of the Lord Jesus, how he said, it's more blessed to give than receive. And of course, Romans 10:9, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and believe in thy heart God raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Oh, the blessed Lord Jesus, his name. Let's speak his name often, Lord Jesus, hallelujah. Romans 14:14, I know and I'm persuaded by the Lord Jesus, Paul said. And 1 Corinthians 5:5, that the Spirit might be saved in the day of the Lord Jesus. 1 Corinthians 6:11, ye are justified in the name of the Lord Jesus. 1 Corinthians 11:23, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. 2 Corinthians 1:14, ye also are ours in the day of the Lord Jesus. And 2 Corinthians 4:10, always bearing about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus. 2 Corinthians 4:14, knowing that he had raised up the Lord Jesus. Galatians 6:17, I bear in my body the marks of the Lord Jesus. Ephesians 1:15, I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus. Philippians 2:19, but I trust in the Lord Jesus. And to me, the climaxing scripture on this emphasis of the Lord Jesus in Colossians 3:17, and whatsoever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father by him. So I say thank you, God our Father, for giving us your Son, the Lord Jesus. Now, as I've been talking about the people with whom I worked for the first 12 years in full-time ministry, I'm convinced these people were those who honored the Lord Jesus as applied to their ministry. It was the name of the Lord Jesus that the miracles occurred, and each of them were devout followers of the Lord Jesus. Now, it's good and appropriate to call his name simply Jesus. It's delight to honor him as the Christ, but there's something special about calling him the Lord Jesus. Hallelujah, the Lord Jesus. Now, I'm talking about heroes, six persons with whom God joined me for a period of 12 years. And to my heroes, the word supernatural was not just a term, it was a life. To them, the supernatural was not a passive feeling, it was a permanent force. The supernatural manifested through my heroes was not a temporal toy, it was an eternal treasure. They flowed in the supernatural, not by human gifts, but by divine love, the Holy Spirit. Love motivated their lives, and passion came before power. And as I carefully observed these heroes over many years, the supernatural came in seeking to meet human needs. Each of them was sent out to heal the sick, open the blinded eyes, and as they went, they saw the supernatural. Personally, as a young man, I felt the pulse beat, as it were, when I had the opportunity to be close to these people. And their quest was the sinner must be saved, the burden must be lifted, the bereaved must be comforted, the sick must be healed. And these people entered the byways of the suffering, sinful, sick, and burdened humanity. God gave them authority over evil because they shared the passion of Jesus. Now, when I speak of these heroes, I've made it clear that they were just ordinary people. They were not some kind of a divine creation. No, they were simply normal, regular people. And they had faults and they had failures, but thank God they also knew how to walk in the love of Christ. Love comes before power. The power of God follows the pathway of the love of God. Jesus healed those for whom he had compassion. And love is the highest manifestation of the Holy Spirit in ministry. So hear me, friend. If you're to be used of God, remember love is the highest manifestation of the Holy Spirit. And it was this manifestation of love that made way for the glorious supernatural. You ask, what was the secret of the power of these people to have command that they exercised? Well, I'm persuaded it was the power of command flowing from the prayer closet. One of my earliest experiences with Freeman was accompanying him through a long, dark night to the home of an Iowa farmer to pray for him. Freeman didn't know the man, but the man's beseeching wife had come to our crusade in Des Moines and pled with Freeman to drive hours through the night to go pray for her sick husband, and Freeman did so. That demonstration of love impressed my young life very deeply. And I want to just emphasize to you, my beloved friend, that God wants you to flow in love. Now, let me just give you a scripture here from Revelation chapter 1, where John wrote, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day, and I heard behind me a great voice like the calling of a war trumpet. Then I turned to see whose was the voice that was speaking to me. And when I saw him, I fell at his feet as if dead. Now, here are the vital questions. How does a man feel in the Spirit? How does a man see in the Spirit? How does a man hear in the Spirit? What does a man know in the Spirit? And these answers are very clearly answered by the Word of God, and it's very valuable to walk in the Spirit, to be in the Spirit. We don't have to linger always in the dark about this engaging subject. John the Revelator wrote, I was in the Spirit in the Lord's day. And any day in the Spirit is the Lord's day, and every Lord's day can be a day in the Spirit. In my travels, in my association with these six people who I call my heroes of faith, I refer to the fact they lived the life in the Holy Spirit. This was a vital key to their great nation-shaking crusades and their ability to be used as instruments in God's hand. Now, if one man, John the Revelator, could be in the Spirit, we can say that other men can also be in the Spirit, even you and me. Because of the baptism of the Holy Spirit, we can make every day the Lord's day to be in the Spirit. Notice John said, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day and heard behind me a great voice of a trumpet. Now, the first reaction reported by the man in the Spirit is he heard. And once we conclude, there's something to hear when you're in the Spirit. Adam heard the voice of the Lord, indicating God has spoken to man from the beginning of time to the end, from Adam to John. And whenever men have heard the voice, there's always been glorious results. My friend Freeman heard the voice of the angel, go and stretch forth your hand, bring healing to the people. Branham heard the voice of the angel, "From this hour, a gift of healing will flow through you." Osborne heard it were a thousand voices above his head saying, "You can do that, you can do that." That's the way Peter and John and Philip and Stephen did, and you can do that. Well, in the Bible accounts of the voice, sometimes men were confused about the voice. John says it was a voice like a trumpet, but those who were at Paul thought they heard thunder. The prophet heard a still small voice. And to me, it's always been interesting to learn of the various reactions to those who hear the voice of the Lord. There are other interesting accounts in the Bible. Samuel, the boy, heard the voice. It was calling his name. Nathanael heard his name. The dead child heard the command of Jesus to arise. The palsied man heard the glad command, "Take up thy bed and walk." The hearted woman heard the sound, "You are forgiven." Oh, that we might hear the voice of the Lord as he would speak to us. And notice, it was something that was so valuable to his people. Now, how did I link up? First of all, William Freeman, he heard a voice say to him, "Invite Don Gossett to travel with you. He will do you good." Those were precious words that changed my whole life, and I will always rejoice in the fact God can speak. And notice John said, "I see." Then I turned to see whose was the voice speaking to me. And the second observation, what John saw. So those of you and I who are in the Spirit can see what the Lord can do. There's so many wonderful ways God works, and I want to challenge you to know the blessing, the dominion, the authority that's available to you. Now, my beloved friend, I've shared with you my heart. I've shared principles that I could employ in a very expanded manner today, but I believe you've seen the simplicity of the lives of these people with whom I worked, how they lived the faith walk, how they walked in love, how they were moved by compassion for the multitudes who were lost, sick, and distressed. And I'm so glad that these were my examples of godly living, and I thank God for them. Now, I'd like to say, in this day, not long ago as it was then, but now, the Lord has connected me with you who care about the lost. And I appreciate your being one of those persons. And 1 John 4:19, we love him because he first loved us. I ask myself, do I really love him? Of course I love him since I was a child. And I'm sure the same is with you. And when the day comes for us to leave this life, it will likely be the name of Jesus will be our last breath. Paul said it in 2 Corinthians 2:14, "Thanks be unto God who always causes us to triumph." When you live by the wisdom of this text, life will become good, and you'll overcome pessimism, sourness, cynicism, all these insidious diseases that sour your spirit. So thank you for your helpful gifts for Bow Bible Missions. And now let's take a praise break and join me together in saying praise the Lord. Let's say it 10 times. Praise the Lord, 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 hallelujah.
Don Gossett is sharing with you his life-changing experience of being teamed with some of God's choice servants. You can receive a very valuable CD by requesting Remember the Works of the Lord CD. Please ask for today's offer by name when you address your letter of support to Box 2, Blaine, Washington, 98231, or in Canada, Box 75120, White Rock, BC, V4A, OB1.